the Parliament of Religion. It was a long journey from Bombay to Chicago. Swami Vivekanand traveled by sea. He had many adventures and met many interesting people. He saw the ports of Singapore and Hong Kong. He visited some temples in China and Japan. The ship crossed the Pacific Ocean. Swami took a train from Vancouver to Canada to Chicago. Swami found out that he was 1 month early for the Parliament of Religions. The devotees, ministers, and the rajas who helped him were unaware of it. Meanwhile, the Swami was raising curiosity with his orange robes and turban. Children followed him as he walked in the street. There were times when Swami got lost. He lacked money for food, transportation, and lodging, but there were always good strangers to help him. Swami realized that God was by his side and watching him. He was sending these people as instruments to help Swami in accomplishing his mission. The Parliament of Religions was officially opened in September 1983. This gathering was part of the World's Columbian Exposition, which was an event to commemorate Christopher Columbus' discovery of America. The goal of the exposition was to exhibit the progress in Western science and technology. But since religion was a major factor in humanity, it was included as well. 7,000 people were inside the big hall. Religious leaders came from all over the world. There were delegates from Islam, Christianity, Shintoism, Confucianism, Buddhism, Hinduism, and Jainism. Each of them was to stand in front and make a speech. Swami Vivekanand was very nervous. He didn't have a prepared speech. He didn't know that he needed one. He was his first time attending this kind of gathering. He asked the organizer to call him last, but soon it was time for his speech. Swami's first words were, "Sisters and brothers of America." The audience was endeared. The Westerners gave him a standing ovation. They all stood up and applauded. Finally, there came a delegate who was sincere in his life's word. Finally, there came a delegate who was sincere in his life's word. The words he said. Swami decided to talk about acceptance and universal tolerance. He talked about how India, even in ancient times, became the refuge of Zoroastrians and Israelites. He explained that people of different religions are like small streams leading out to the sea. The water flows from different sources, but they all end up at sea. That great sea is God. He spoke not only about his own religion, but about all religions of the world. That was what made Swami Vivekanand stand out in the gathering. He also made out a call to the modern world to stop discrimination and to accept all creeds, all colors, and all castes. Swami said that we are all the same. Each of us should be incorporated into single humanity. But also made Swami stand out was that he never criticized other religions. He didn't try to prove that this or that religion was the ultimate truth. He believed that all religions lead to God. He said that there were many doors to enter a mansion. On the last day of the parliament, Swami Vivekanand concluded that the parliament of religions has proved to the world that charity, purity, and holiness were present in every religion. He said, if there is one religion, religious leader who desires his own to dominate over all the rest, I will pity him. He also said that soon every religion would have this banner, harmony and peace, not destruction. Almost overnight, the strange young monk from India became a celebrity. People admired his words and holiness. There were life-sized portraits of Swami Vivekanand posted all over the Chicago. Below his image were the words, "The monk Vivekanand." Those who passed by his poster would stop to bow their heads. The news about the Parliament of Religions reached India. Swami's speech was published in the newspapers and magazines. The Hindus all over the country became proud of Swami Vivekanand. His brothers at the monastery could not believe that it was him. When he wrote a letter to them, that's when the young monks realized that it's really Naren. Swami did not want to depend on the generosity of his new Western friends. He accepted invitations to lecture all over America so he could earn money. He spread his message of kindness and acceptance. Swami Vivekanand had lectures in New York, Boston, Washington, and Cambridge, among others. He once had a goal, and now he has reached it. He has made Hinduism known to the whole world. He can finally help his poor brothers and sisters in India. Vedanta in America. A group of poor students rented a cheap apartment in New York. They raised the money so that Swami Vivekanand could have regular lectures there. He usually sat on the floor. The audience occupied by space they could find. The door was always left open. The lectures were always free. There was one session in the morning and again in the evening. The Swami was very happy to educate these young students. They were eager to learn. They didn't mind if it was crowded or if there was no place to sit. They just listened intently to Swami's words. Swami taught them about Gyan Yoga so that they would know the truth of Vedanta. He also taught them Raj Yoga so that they would master concentration, meditation, and self-control. The students also followed his vow of simplicity and chastity. There were more serious students with whom he meditated every day. He showed them how from intense concentration a person could free himself from bodily consciousness. It was in America where Swami Vivekanand was able to publish his four classics, which were the Raj Yoga, Gyan Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, and Karma Yoga. They were well received by his followers. Among them were professors, doctors, businessmen, and church leaders. Return to India. Thousands of people were waiting for the Swami Vivekanand at the port. They were filled with joy, and when they finally saw his robes, they were cheering out for him. All of them flung themselves to the ground to respect him. The Swami was welcomed by the leaders of Ceylon. A huge procession was prepared for him. There was an Indian band Flowers were thrown on his path. He was sprinkled with rose water and holy water from Ganga. The smell of incense filled the air. The people offered him fruits and other gifts. Swami appreciated this warm welcome. He accepted everything that the people did for him. In his speech, he commended the spirituality of the Hindus. He was not a prince or a wealthy man. He was not an army general either. Yet he was given much respect and honor. He is a sannyasi, a beggar, and a homeless monk. But the people did for him is a high indication of spirituality. For that, he was very thankful. Swami went to Madras and then to Calcutta. Everywhere he went, people waited for him. They were eager to see him and hear his teachings. One follower asked him if he ever got tired in all his activities. Swami Vivekanand replied that a man never gets tired of spiritual activities. There were those who came to debate with him or to challenge his teachings. There were also those who came to test his knowledge. The Swami still received them, but he chose to focus on the young man who desired to be trained by him. He had always been passionate about educating the youth. There was one frustrated young man who came to Swami. He complained that he could not find spiritual awakening. The young man said that he had tried everything. He followed all the advices of his teachers. He worshipped images the best way he could. He shut all the doors in his room. He kept his eyes closed. He willed himself to sit still in meditation, but still the young man could not achieve peace of mind. "What should I do?" he asked the Swami. The voice of Swami was full of sympathy. "My son, you should open all the doors and open your eyes as well. Look around," he told the young man, "to see the many poor and the helpless people in his community. He should give all his efforts in serving them. If they are hungry, give them food. If they are sick, give them medicine. If they are ignorant, give them an education. Dedicate yourself to taking care of your poor neighbors. If you offer yourself fully in serving them, it's only then that you will have a peace of mind." The rest we will discuss in part 4. Thanks.